Hello and welcome to Look Out with me, Andrew Kay, and to my very festive sofa. I'm delighted. I've got friends in, new friends Yay. Today. I've got Resi Wakeley and Alison Child. They've come in with their Father Christmas hats on, which is
As
very
instructed.
Jolly of them. Absolutely. New friend Gemma Ogston is going to talk to me about her healthy food book. Mm. She's looking at me being fat old lump over here.
I'm
Quite
not
clearly she thinks
at all.
I might need it. And my dear, dear old friend Ty Jeffries, and we're going to be talking about chives. Well, you're looking after her, don't you? The
yes.
delightful and rather wonderful Miss Hope Springs.
Yes.
We'll get on to that in a little while. It's great, and we've got a special guest coming in later because it's Christmas
Yay.
And we can do it.
Exciting.
So let's start off with you, Gemma. You've written a book.
I have.
About healthy eating.
Yeah, would you like to see it?
It's published this week.
It's
right?
published on Thursday, yeah. It's
the
called
Self-Care Cookbook.
The Self-Care Cookbook. Do you want to have a look?
Oh, I've had a quick look at it already because everyone that knows me knows I'm crazy about food
yeah.
and cooking. And people sometimes say, oh, you're so fat, Andrew. And I say, this is not fat.
Oh.
This is a CV. because having written about food for 28 years now,
yeah.
this is actually the record of my indulgence.
And
I am more aware of healthy eating.
Yeah, and I wouldn't... I mean, it is healthy eating, but it's. I mean, it's called the Self-Care Cookbook because I wanted to write a book about food as a form of self-care and kind of moving away from diets and losing weight and eating something because it's the new craze or the new trend. It's about eating food to help boost your mood, help you sleep and reduce anxiety and, yeah, make you feel good, basically.
And I have to say, although we are post-watershed, I would rather we didn't use that terrible word. Diet.
Yeah, hate it. I don't. I mean, for me, I diet is not a word that is in my language. It's so you know the recipes in there. They're all plant based because I follow a plant based diet, which is no meat. But you know, we were just talking about eating pizza, weren't we? Because you know, it's okay to have pizza. It's all about balance, I think. You know.
Well, I think this as well. And people say to me, "Oh, you're really indulgent. You must spend your life because I write restaurant." Reviews. You must like,
Ooh,
spend your life
you.
Eating foie gras and caviar and you think, yeah, you know.
Don't you, Andrew?
Not in my world, absolutely
yeah.
not. And at home, I try to be healthy. In fact, inspired by you at the weekend, I ate tofu.
Amazing.
Which, I know so many people say to me, tofu is revolting, it doesn't taste of anything. It's delicious.
Yeah.
Mm. And I love the texture of it as well. And people
yeah.
say, oh, it's the texture, it's slippery.
Yeah.
I said, so you don't like oysters?
Yeah,
you don't
it's
like,
similar, isn't it?
You don't
it?
Like creme caramel?
Mm.
I mean, they're all slippery and they're all delicious.
And we were chatting earlier, it's about what you do with the tofu. So, you know, marinate yeah. it before, use loads of flavours or fry it to make it a bit crispy. Don't just, you know, cut it off the block and put it in your mouth. It might be a bit bland. But...
Well, it's bland, isn't it? But it
yeah.
carry flavours beautifully.
Yes.
It's wonderful. I'm also passionate about home cooking and this, to me, looks like it's about home cooking. Too many food books at the moment, they're a bit too precious, aren't they? You know, you look at them, you open them, I get sent loads of the damn things. And I open it up and I think, well, it's all very nice, but I'm not going to make it.
Yeah. Yeah. No. I mean, I've tried to keep, because I'm generally always in a rush. I've got, you know, small children and always busy. So I've tried to keep every recipe really short, you know, like between 15 minutes or half an hour.
Yeah.
And all of the ingredients list is very short and stuff that you can buy in the supermarket. And it's low budget because. You know, having, you know, opening a recipe book and then going, oh my God, I've got to go and spend £1 million on 1,000 ingredients is makes
that
it...
the worst thing when
yeah,
you go to a supermarket?
Yeah.
And I watch people walking around supermarkets with the recipe book.
Yeah.
And they're going, oh, I need that and I need that. And they get to the cash registers and they've spent £80 and they're only doing two
yeah.
courses.
That's
because
ridiculous.
I go out and shop and I go and look at what looks nice.
Yeah.
And I buy what looks nice, knowing that I've got a good pantry at home, and take it home and then I think about what I'm going to do with it.
Yeah.
And I might then think, oh, there's a great recipe in that book.
Yeah.
And I'll have a dig around. I mean, I have got one favourite recipe book, which is so brown now. You could boil
you've
it.
Used it so many
well,
times.
You could boil it and make very good soup.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've had it since I was at art school.
Yeah.
And it's called the Yorkshire TV Farmhouse Cookbook.
And what's your favourite recipe from it?
Oh, it's this wonderful pudding called Lemon Dainty,
oh.
where you mix everything in a bowl, bung it in the tray, stick it in the oven, and when you take it out, you leave it for 15 minutes.
Yum.
And in 15 minutes, the sponge rises to the top, and the lemon curd drops to the bottom. It's so pleasant. It's magic.
Do you know what, actually, I've got with me?
Oh, what have you brought?
I have bought some mint pies. Would you want... They're not in the recipe book, but as it's Christmas, I thought, let's hear.
Now, this is
self-care
mince pie.
This is a self-care mince pie. It's self-care because it makes you feel happy when you're eating it, and I think that's a big part of something that people have forgotten.
I think that's
forgotten. You have to love food, and, like, I try and make all my food colourful and bright.
I'm bored with pleasure-free food.
I mean, these aren't... I must say, these aren't... The appearance isn't amazing, but, you know, they taste good. They taste good.
So, and there's no sugar in it.
I haven't worked with children and animals or eat mince pies.
No sugar. So maple
How
syrup.
How do you make it so sweet?
Maple syrup. Mm. But I've been marinating. There is sherry in these, which are, you know, it's Christmas.
The pastry is lovely and sure.
Thank you. But yeah, nice. So it's, you know, my book is about self-care cooking, self-care food, food to boost your mood or give you a little bit of... One of my favourite sections in the book is called Cozy. You know, recipes for when you want to be cozy and you just want to snuggle up and be inside. And I think at this time of year when there's a million party invites and so many things to do, you know, which can feel really overwhelming, sometimes it's just good to say, you know what, no, I'm going to get cozy and...
I noticed that actually throughout the book there are moods. And you sort of say joy, connected, and it's lovely. And you're actually theming the food for occasions.
So, for instance... Sorry, I'm going to need to finish my mince pie. You know, connected is all about when you have people around you. And, you know, that doesn't need to be a massive table full of 100 friends. It might just be you and one other person. But that feeling of wanting to create a dish or make some food that you can share with someone and it makes you feel connected in a special way, I think, is really, for me, one of the best things about eating and food. Because I grew up in a very big family. That's how I learned to cook. My mum taught me to cook. We always had loads of people round my house. You know, there was always a big pot of soup on the go and anyone could come in and it was always loud and noisy and chaotic. And, you know, that's one of my sort of oldest memories of eating. And I love it. I love it when I've got a chaotic dinner table, which I'd have most nights with my
children. One of the
children.
Things that fascinates me about recipe books, and in my previous life as a book designer, I designed a lot of recipe books and I would direct the photography. And after I'd done the first one, I looked at the invoices and we had an invoice for the photographer and the photographer's assistant and for the hire of the plates and the backdrops and one for the home economist. And the next time I did a food book, I said to the author, I said, why don't you come in and cook the dishes and we'll photograph them because they're your recipes. Did you cook these for the photographs or were they done by a home economist?
Well, I did all the photos in my book, so I did everything. So everything in that book, all of the only photo I didn't do actually was the front cover. A lovely photographer from Brighton, he's called James Bellarini, did the front cover because it needed to be with a certain camera.
Yep.
But we, you know, we were all there and styled
it. The great thing about doing them yourself and actually photographing the food that you've cooked is that when someone follows your recipe, that's what it's going to look like.
Yeah.
Whereas home economists, I mean, honestly, I spent ages with one girl and she was glazing a goose with glycerine to make it look roasted. Yeah. I said, why didn't we just roast it? And I watched her, and this is no joke, I watched her
with
plasticine and toothpicks. She put little plasticine balls in the bottom of the soup plate, toothpicks, and then she balanced the vegetables on the toothpicks and then poured the clear broth in. It was all fake, and I just said, there's nothing more disappointing than following a recipe and looking at your delicious but not pretty stew.
Yeah.
And looking at the book and realising that that was bits of fillet steak floating around in the stove.
Yeah.
And that's what they were doing. And from that point on, I never did it again.
I mean, I try with all my photos. I mean, it's a very, you know, I take photos in my front room and a little table that I bought at a car boot sale for a fiver. And I do a lot of all the photos on my social media with my phone. So it's all...
They look great.
It might have been a bit glammed up for the book, but generally they are the dish. And that's what it is, because it's about the food. You
Your book is out on Thursday.
It's
published by
Thursday.
Vermilion, and it's £14.99.
It is, and you can...
Vermilion are a branch of Penguin Books.
Yes, with Ebury Publishing.
Big league.
Who've been absolutely amazing. Yeah, and they actually got in contact with me through my Instagram, so it was pretty amazing.
That is impressive, isn't it?
Yeah. Well done. So that was a year ago today, so Yeah, I've got my... It's going to be in the shop, so Waterstones, Urban Outfitters, you can buy it on Amazon, and locally, City Books.
Mm-hmm. Oh, we love City Books.
Yeah, they're amazing. And they're going to be at my launch party selling the books as well.
Marvellous.
And then Cookbook Bake, which is... Do you know that shop in Hove? The seafront, yes. Yeah. Another amazing Marvellous. Shop.
Mm. Brilliant. Yeah. Listen, we're going to go to a break now, and in the interval, I'm going to ask Ty to choose something so that... Next time he invites me around for dinner, he can make it for me.
Amazing.
We'll see you after these ads.
Look out. Look out. We're here for you.
Hello, welcome back to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay, and my lovely guest this week. I'm going to talk to Ty now, because you've just stuffed your face on mince pies.
Delicious.
Aren't they good?
Delicious. Maple syrup infused.
Sherry infused.
Sherry infused, sugar-free. And mince pies was delicious. I think I'm a little bit high now.
You're a little bit tipsy. Yeah, there's quite a lot of sherry in them.
Levels.
Well, Ty, you spend a lot of your life needing to reach a level of high to perform, yes. Because your alter ego, the wonderful and extraordinary Miss Hope Springs, is a demanding creature in your life.
She is. I call her my female personage.
Oh, really?
Yes. And I call it gender trompe l'oeil. and she is very... she takes everything I've got, really. I don't have very much for myself left. I live on crumbs. She has this fabulously glamorous life, so...
Well, she is incredibly glamorous, and I was very fortunate because in late summer I was able to come out to Edinburgh and see your show.
My award-winning show.
Award-winning show.
Best Cabaret Edinburgh Fringe 2019.
Yes. Excellent.
Yes. Yes, thank you. I'm very shy about
it. We were sat there for hours voting and voting and voting. No, I did vote, but I only didn't. I'm sensible. I voted once. I don't like those things where you can fake them. Right, are they?
No, they check it. They check it all.
Yeah. But it was a fantastic show. But I could see by the end of the performance... You were absolutely drained.
Yes.
And, because you have to stay absolutely in character through the whole thing, and she's not an easy woman.
No, she's not. Well,
she's troubled.
She's as easy as the audience is. You know, if they're gracious and on the ball, she's fine. But if they, you know, are difficult or perhaps heckle...
Oh, was Andrew making life difficult for
no,
you?
No.
I never heckle. I mean, it's very interesting. And I ask this to most performers that come in. You do the show in different cities. Is the response always different?
Always different. Mm. I toured the United States a couple of years ago, and I have to say that audiences in America are just ready to embrace you immediately you walk on stage. In any of the cities that I played, it was the same sort of excitement and openness. And in England, there's a bit of, like in Edinburgh, I mean, some shows I had, you know, about 150 people in who'd never seen Miss Hope Springs before. And you know, they, one night, it was like there were 35 Koreans in the audience who didn't understand a word I was saying, but they loved the
clap. Did they enjoy it?
Yeah.
They joined in.
They joined in.
Yeah.
But British audiences are a little bit more reserved, and sometimes if they haven't seen the show before, it takes them a while to warm up. But once they know Miss Hope Springs and know that you're entering another world, they come on board, and that's why they keep coming back to see the show.
I mean, your gender trompe l'oeil is so convincing, and especially in the photographs. Do you think people ever come along thinking that Hope is in fact?
They do. A real lady.
Mm. A real lady survivor of Las Vegas.
Yeah, I mean. The main venue I play in London is Adele, and I've had friends of mine come and see the show, and then they go to the loo afterwards, and now people in there talking about Miss Hope Springs. They wonder when does she go back to Vegas?
Amazing.
And, you know, yeah. and they really believe. I mean, somebody very very sophisticated came to see the show. It was Michel Legrand's agent in England for very sophisticated French guy, and at the interval he said, "She's very tall, isn't she?"
With very big hands.
Well, I'm very lucky because I don't have big
hands.
Well,
they're not that big.
You've got tiny, tiny hands.
But they're not that big.
They're not.
No,
I don't
yeah,
have, and I've got no. size 8 women's feet.
Wow.
So oh, I can lucky
just
you.
New you can look. Just go and get so many shoes. Yeah,
yeah, up, but everything amazing. Else I have to make.
You see, I couldn't do it. I've got size 12, so yeah. a bit clumsy.
Let's not go any further with that.
But the cabaret world has embraced you, hasn't it? I mean, wholly.
Well, that's very nice. I hope so.
Yeah.
I hope so. It's a funny old. It's a funny world. It's there's not as much camaraderie as I would hope. I always wanted to be sort of like old Hollywood.
Mm. Well, actually, you say that because you grew up in Hollywood. I mean, your history is quite extraordinary. I remember when I first met you, you told me that regular figures in your family life were people like Fred Astaire.
Yeah, wow. Well,
yeah. Yes, my uncle Fred was Fred Astaire.
Fred.
Wow.
And my dad made a movie called Notorious Landlady with Fred Astaire, Kim Novak, Jack Lemmon, and they became great friends. And he used to come and stay the weekend at our house in Buckinghamshire. And
what was he like?
Oh, lovely, very gentle and charming and fun too.
And your playmates as a child were glamorous too.
Who were they?
I'm just assuming they were.
I can't remember.
Who did you go
out? A bloody long time ago.
Did you go out playing with Liza Minnelli and people like that?
I'm sure I did.
Yeah.
I'm sure I did. No, it was mainly the adults. I mean, I did play with Terry Thomas, his children. He had a son called Tim, called Tiny Tim, and who else? And that was about it. Was like, no, I wasn't really interested in the kids. It was the it was the older stars coming through. The how Diana Dawes, which was my mum's and dad's great friend. She
wonderful.
Got to the house a lot. And one day I came home and Elton John was sitting on the sofa.
Oh my goodness.
Lulu and the Bee Gees were having tea.
Oh, it makes my life at home seem so ordinary. So
well, it's been mundane. Downhill ever since for me.
Well, not for us. This is very glamorous. This is very glamorous. I think one thing that people perhaps need to know about you is the fact that you write all your own materials, not just the scripts, but the songs are all original songs.
They
and
are.
You play the piano, and I know you play the piano beautifully.
Thank you.
But the songs are all scripted by you.
Yeah, I write all the music and the lyrics and created a back catalogue for Hope Well. It goes back some 10 years now because Andrew...
Well, I think I filmed you about 10 years ago in a restaurant in Brighton playing a wonderful song. Vintage.
Was it Carnival? Did I
Carnival yes. and
I was only 12 at the time.
Yeah,
vintage.
Yes.
But also you gave me a beautiful review in latest magazine.
Yes.
And
once you've seen the show, it's sort of very difficult to drag yourself away from going again and again because there's new material every time.
Yeah.
You're not recycling. I mean, some of the great songs you will do again, but. The Devil Made Me Do It, I should imagine, is going to be in Hope's set
well, as
forever.
They, as they send me into the flaming furnace when I expire, I hope they'll play that.
I think that's such a nice idea. Not that it's a nice idea thinking about cremating you.
I can tell you there are a lot of people on the cabaret scene who'd love to see me go up in smoke.
But if I'm around at the time, then I will send a note.
You please make sure.
Note to Undertaker.
Yes.
Must go down the chute.
Absolutely.
The Devil Made Me Do It.
The Devil Made Me Do It. It's wonderful,
It's a theme song.
Is it available on YouTube?
It is. Hope's various albums are all on Apple Music.
Now, Alison, Rosie,
Hello.
You're championing the world of Nord Lady and Clone Farrah, and you're actually going to sing a song for us from their repertoire.
We are going to sing.
So I think we're going to have a little break and let them get ready to sing this great tune for us now.
There's a missy that's got me dizzy and how, and she's the sweetest thing that you've ever seen. Oh, how you'll love her. I'm just aching to win that maiden somehow. Oh, honey, can't you guess? Then I must confess. Pretty little Mandy, I wanna be your little dandy. Say you're as sweet as lasses can be, And I'm always thinking about you, can't sleep without you, Mandy. Say you can bet I'm always handy, sitting around on your verandy, Mandy, dreaming of you, of you. Can't you see I'm lonely? Nobody else could ever own me. Nobody else has ever shown me what love can do. And all my troubles would go away if you could name the day. Oh, Mandy, I'm in love with no one else but you. You're as sweet as that as can be. And I'm always thinking about you, can't sleep without you, Mandy. So you can bet I'm always handy, sitting around on your verandy, Mandy, dreaming of you, of you. Can't you see I'm lonely? Nobody else could ever own me. Nobody else has ever shown me what love can do. And all my troubles would go away if you could name the day. Oh, Mandy, I'm in love with no one else but you.
Look out, we're here for you. Look out, we're here for you.
Hello, welcome back to Look Out with me, Andrew Kay. And what's that I can hear in the distance? It's my good friend, Father Christmas. Father Christmas, how lovely to come back this year. So nice having you here last year. And I know your schedule is so busy. I mean, you must be zooming around everywhere.
Absolutely. And of course, it has to be to come to see you, Andrew, every year. It's almost a tradition now, isn't it?
Well, yeah. I think 2 years in, it has become a tradition.
Yes,
already.
Yes. It's, as long as we're not repetitive. I can't remember what I said last year. Never mind.
Well, you must be busy and seeing so many children. Do you find year on year children change?
Oh, yes, absolutely. It is a humbling experience because I'm currently appearing at Tunbridge Wells at the Royal Victoria Place, and I'm astounded how many children of all ages. I've broken my record this year, 10-week-old baby.
10-week-old baby.
I did have a pregnant lady mum, and I said, "When are you due?" And she said, "Tomorrow." And I said, "Well, I haven't got. I'm not a midwife. I'm sorry. I can't help you there." No, I did. But I'm astounded at the amount. We have an awful lot of autistic children with sensory days, that sort of thing, and all the age groups. I even had a gentleman who. I hate using that expression, but he was autistic. He was 28. Mm-hmm. His knowledge of Star Wars was astounding. And that's what we have. We have such a myriad of different people. So to actually see all sorts of people, and that includes big folk, because a lot of them still believe, you know. Don't you, Tom?
Oh, I still
believe.
You've been coming to know.
I noticed I missed out on the mince pies, but that's
another story. Well, there is one over there. Get it in your beard.
Oh, yes, we don't get it in this. This is really so well.
I think the first time I saw you, Father Christmas, I would have been 3 years old, and it was at Lewis's, in Liverpool.
Yes.
And we took a train ride, which was really lovely. You sat in the carriage of the train and the world went by on rollers. But it was so magical. And Mum has got a photograph of me from that day, sat on Father Christmas's knee. I mean, your knees must take some pressure. I mean, that was 60 years ago. And you've been doing it for a lot longer than that.
I'm 242. I don't know what you've got to worry about, my dear. No, it's astounding, the amount of children. It's not so much children. Then you get, like, a one-year-old come to you going on 13, because they are huge. And I look at the parents and I say, what have you been feeding this child on? I mean, probably a few of your recipes might be involved there.
I think there might be, yeah, yes, absolutely.
But it's astounding. I do have a... Then you get the cheeky ones that, shall we say, have been slightly on the sherry. And they're going past because you're on display the whole time, which is a bit almost like being a monkey in a zoo. And what does happen is that they think that because they're very funny and start shouting at you, all sorts of sometimes abuse, but there we are, I can deal with that. They go straight onto the naughty list. They come bounding towards you and land. And it is you're old, like I am, and Father Christmas suffers from sciatica.
Yeah, not surprising, is it, really?
I've broken three pairs of glasses by sitting on them in the driving seat of the sleigh.
Oh, yes. Those sleighs don't have very good suspension, do they?
Shocking.
Awful.
Shocking. Awful.
So the kids come home and do a running jump?
Normally the adults. It's extraordinary. And then you do get the little shy ones, of course. But I don't want any of these children to have a negative experience because there are three things when I was young that I could not, and it's many centuries ago now. One was Brussels sprouts, one was rhubarb, and one was gooseberries. I adore Brussels sprouts, but I was forced to eat them back in those days. Rhubarb and gooseberries is the work of the devil.
Well, you see, I like all of them. But I think if you like those weird tasting things, and they are odd, then you like them all, don't you? I think
they're doing Brussels sprout crisps.
I did notice that. I don't think there's any need.
I don't think they've ever been near a Brussels sprout in
there. Of course not.
Or even a potato, to be quite honest.
Everyone who's watching has met Father Christmas. When did you first meet Father Christmas?
I never actually met him, I have to say.
Did Mummy and Daddy never take you to the local department store to meet
Father
Christmas?
To be honest, no, because I think it was complicated. But I used to hear Father... I had to go to bed early on Christmas Eve and I would hear the sleigh bells coming in the garden and ho, ho, ho. I heard you going ho, ho, ho in your sleigh bells, but I wasn't allowed to see you.
No.
Well, yes, but so what you're saying is child looked for a Father Christmas virgin.
Yes, I... My
But partner. It seems to me that these are rules. I'll do them for you. Go to bed early, sleep all night, wake up late. And when you've thrown all the paper around the front room, put it in the recycling.
Yes.
Very important.
And that way, if it comes from me, they're going to do it.
Of course.
If a parent or somebody or nanny or whoever's involved, the guardian, says that, they're going to totally ignore it.
May I ask a question?
Of course.
These days, do you still get cookies and milk? And is sometimes the milk a plant-based alternative?
Yes, I know what you mean, because there's some they make milk out of some very peculiar things.
Yes.
And frankly, I prefer it to come from a cow.
Yes.
You can get reindeer milk, which is actually quite nice, and goat milk's quite nice, but when you come out with things like oat milk...
Mm. Oh, yes.
No. And soya milk. I know if you make... Because I do like a hot beverage. Litres of it. Mm. And if you put that soya milk in and it's too hot, it turns into this... Well, it looks a bit
curds.
Curds. And it's not appetizing.
I sort of object to the fact that almond milk, which everyone tells me is delicious, to make a litre of almond milk takes 6 almonds. And a litre of water.
Really?
And it's whizzed up frantically to make this thing. Well, why does it cost nearly £2 for a litre?
And why aren't
6
almonds are salted or wrapped in chocolate?
Much better. Much better.
You like an almond.
When did you first meet Father Christmas?
I would have been already on the lookout for Mother Christmas, I think.
Oh, really?
The day. Yeah. I'd like to have seen Valerie Singleton in a nice little red skirt.
She's a lovely woman.
Well, let's share our fantasy, shall we?
What about you, Rosie? I can't remember. It might have been in Churchill Square when it was... Before it was...
When it was a wind tunnel.
Yes. I think I did that. I thought it was a bit drafty.
It wasn't the wind tunnel because of you eating your sprouts.
Well, you know, you've said it. You know what I fancy for later on? Sprouts.
Yeah.
I might have to pop over to one of your wonderful supermarkets. Because in Lapland, you know, where
you
say Hoover Eula, we actually don't have... You know, that means Merry Christmas.
Oh, that's lovely.
We don't really have the...
you know, things like Brussels sprouts coming in, because all the it has to come in.
So what do you feed your little helpers on?
Well,
it depends. I hope they're getting minimum wage.
I'll tell you what, it's not plant-based milk, I can tell you that. They do like, I mean, this is another thing I do say to the small folk all over the world, is the fact that if you're going to eat sweets, brush your teeth after, because being so old, I've got less hair than some of the children who are 1 year of age, and they've certainly got more teeth than I've got. So that is a very, very important thing.
Well, it's always carrots.
And well, you see,
because you're stealing Rudolf's carrots, aren't you?
Well, I do like a bit of
carrot. See, you say cookies and milk here. It's mince pie and a carrot for Rudolf.
Oh, is it?
Yes.
I actually do like a drop of vino tinto, to be honest.
Are you?
Or a nice port. Or
it was always a glass of sherry when I was growing up, but that's because Mum and Dad never really had booze in the house.
Well, I like
only at Christmas.
Do you know what? I really like anything.
Yes.
To be honest.
Bit of a drink.
But when it comes to hot drinks, I can't stand these little things that you're paying £2.90 for in your currency. Right. I have, which I was given, a great big, I think it's called Pyrex. I do understand there's other containers and hot drinks.
Yes.
And it's a litre. And that's what I have my tea.
A litre of tea?
A litre of tea.
In Pyrex?
Yeah, in a Pyrex measuring
tray. I mean, that's very brave, because let's face it, on Christmas Eve, you're in your sleigh, you've got to cover the whole of the world, and you've drunk litres and litres of tea.
I do have the help of a Time Lord. We stop time.
Ah, I see.
Because it's getting bigger. This Earth is getting bigger and bigger. There's more population. It's difficult to get round.
Because I can imagine you.
I'm not as young as I was.
Haven't you pull in service stations and lay-by so you can use the facilities?
Even if it's not Christmas Eve, I do suffer, and I know this is after 9 o'clock, I do suffer what is I like to call the 4:30 in the morning gentleman's excuse me.
Oh, yes, me too.
But I think most gentlemen of a certain age...
Absolutely.
I don't know about ladies, of course.
Yes, ladies too.
Yeah, you do have to. And then I have, in Lapland, I have a lovely doctor called David, and he does say to me, well, Father Christmas, the situation is it's not the fact that you've got any problems in that department, it's the fact you drink litres of tea before you go to bed.
Listen, we're going to go to a break, and when we come back, we'll talk a little bit more to Father Christmas, Ty, Alison and Rosie, and I think Alison and Rosie have prepared another song for us. We'll see you after these ads.
Look out, we're here for you. The bottom lines, they make me feel so free. Look out, we're here for you.
Hello, welcome back to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay, and my guests, Rosie, Alison, Ty, and Father Christmas. It's so lovely having the real thing, isn't it? You see so many fakes around, so many poor imitations, but to get the real one here is a real privilege. And, do you go on holiday the rest of the year? Where does Father Christmas go for his holes?
St. Lucia. Or Costa Rica.
And you've got a swimming cozy in?
Well, about the 27th of December, guess what? It all comes off. Give it a pull, Tycho. Not too hard, because I might flush.
It's lovely. It's very,
see, I think
very
that's
soft.
How you tell when you've got the real thing or not.
Yeah.
The beard's real. I have a lot of people come up to me and laugh and pull my moustache. Because they think, for some reason, that a grown man would walk round the streets with a fake moustache on. Which is a bit bizarre, isn't it?
I would understand if it was a grown woman going round.
Yeah.
Not in Brighton, it's fine.
Well, no. This comes off in January. Well, it comes off in January because it's very nice to give the face a rest.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. And of course, incognito, I mean, you don't want people running up and wanting to sit on your lap at the poolside.
It's not... Well, no, certainly... Well, yes.
Well,
not with all this. You know what I mean? And it's nice to actually get away. But you can, so I can take the glasses off. These are real glasses. They're not as you can see.
They are real, yes.
But I can take them off.
242, what do you expect?
Sometimes it's a good idea to take your glasses off because you can't see, you know, anyone's coming towards you, you know, and all that. Stick your head in a book and hope for the best. But no, it's nice to get. One has to go and get a bit of heat occasionally.
Of course, of course. Every year there must be favourite Christmas gifts that are going round, what people are asking for. I know this year everyone is going to be asking for a copy of Alison's book.
Well, of course they are.
And
yes.
It was launched a few weeks ago now, and I know you've been in and talked about it, but how's it going?
It's going really well. I was at the post office this morning with copies going off around the world.
It's amazing, isn't it?
I, in fact, sent one to Finland, not quite Lapland or the North Pole, but Finland today, Dublin. And Eastern.
I can drop a few off for you.
Oh, would you? I've got several in my bag.
What
please
a good
do
idea.
And that lovely.
But it's so lovely that it's going well.
It is.
And of course,
I'm really
pleased. I'm hoping now that Gemma's book will be on everybody's Christmas
list.
Yes,
the plant-based food. That looks plant-based really
plant-based
good.
Delights. Mm. I love the fact that she says plant-based and not the V word. Which is nice, isn't it? Because I have problems that people say, knowing that I like food, they say, in restaurants, they say, do you have any allergies or intolerances? And I usually now say, well, I'm totally allergic to vegetarians and I'm completely intolerant of vegans. It usually gets a stunned silence. But on one occasion, it got a free bottle of wine because it made the waiter laugh so much.
That's
really good.
Good for him.
What are children asking for this year?
I think we have spoken before, Andrew, it's trying to put them off track of... Certainly when you've got a four-year-old asking for an iPhone 11...
Yes.
Then what I say to that little tyke, I'll say, how much pocket money do you get? And, of course, they start the cogs are going, you know, and they say, oh, well, about £6 a week. And I go,
£6 a week?
And then I say... So how are you going to pay for the contract each month? Because I don't know, unless you do pay as you go, but knowing you little ones, it's not going to last. You pay as you go, it's not going to last. And of course, there's the other thing, like the egg box, I call them, which are Xboxes. Put them off. I think we discussed it once before. Put them all off there. But the thing, the LOL dolls this year.
What are they?
No idea.
Laugh out loud dolls. Bizarre.
There's a lovely television program called Paw Patrol. That's very popular. And of course, Lego.
Now you see, I'm with you on Lego, but I grew up with Lego. Mm. Although I must confess, I went to the Lego store thinking I'll buy some Lego for someone, and Lego these days is jigsaws, basically. Mm. There's a picture on the lid, and it's what you can make with the contents of the box. When I was growing up, Lego were just bricks, and it left the rest to your imagination. Yeah. And I think that's wonderful. My mum is being rebellious this year. We have a great nephew, and she said, I'm not going to buy him one of these silly modern things. She said, I've ordered him an Etch-a-Sketch. And I thought, that is actually quite good fun, isn't it, to have that retro toy.
And do you remember the, it was a face, and you had a magnet.
Oh, yes, I like those.
Filings, and you could put your eyebrows in
the box. Yes. And sometimes it was black chain for the mouth.
Yeah.
Yes.
Lego,
yes,
I have right, a rule. Yes. Father Christmas rule, number 57, is for Lego, is I always look at the mum, dad, whoever, it could be a nanny for all I know, couldn't it? And say, what form of vacuum cleaner do you have? And it will be any of a myriad of things. And I say, well, Mr. Henry does not like young man. Any Lego bricks up his flue.
Quite right, too.
And I don't like coming when I morph down, because I have to morph to get down some of these very thin chimneys. And, of course, we don't want to stand on it.
No, it's agony,
painful.
Isn't it?
Have you ever stood on a Lego brick?
Dangerous.
Yes.
Dangerous.
Never forget it.
No.
The other thing is cars. You can imagine. Like that.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I don't want to do that. Not with my sciatica.
No.
Thank you all so much for coming in. I do believe that Alison and Rosie have prepared an extra little bit of Christmas festive ditty for us to go out to. But until then, thank you, Rosie. Thank you, Alison. Thank you, Ty. Thank you, Gemma, who's had to rush off and make some more plant-based mince pies because we've eaten them all. And thank you so much, Father Christmas, for coming in. I hope you'll come again next year.
It's always a pleasure. and to some extent a privilege to be in your presence, Andrew.
You're very kind. Thank you for watching. Let's see what they prepared for us.
Yay! Now... Oh! Bells jingle, bells jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride on a wonderful open sleigh. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride on a one-horse open sleigh. Hey, Rosie. I say, what do Santa's little helpers learn at school?
I've no idea.
The alphabet. Oh.
Boom, boom.
Oh, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh.
I say, what's the best Christmas present you can get?
Oh, I hope you've got it for me, Rosie. What is it?
It's a broken drum.
You just can't beat it.
Boom, boom. Oh, corny as anything. Here we go.
Jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride on a one-horse open sleigh. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. So, what do angry mice send each other at Christmas?
I don't know, Ali. What do angry mice send each other at Christmas?
Cross mouse cards.
No.
And what camel? Oh, no, what carol gets played in the desert?
Oh, come all ye faithful.
Woo!
Oh, come all ye faithful.
The way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh.
Goodbye.